بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. We started the book of the prayer. قال المصنف: كتاب الصلاة يجب على كل مسلم مكلف لا حائضا ونفساء، ويقضي من زال عقله بنوم أو إغماء أو سكر ونحوه. After studying the introduction of this book of the Salah, the meaning of the book, the meaning of the Salah, the importance of the prayer, then we said the prayer as a pillar of Islam, it is an obligation of every Muslim mukallif. And we studied the meaning of takleef and al-mukallif, and who is the mukallif, and those who will be in a state of ha'il or nufasa, they will not be obligated to do it as long they are on the state of menstruation or of nifas. وَيَقْضِي, then this is the salat will not be made up, as we mentioned in the book of when we study al-hayd or nifas. Then who is obligated to make up the prayer? Are those قَالَ وَيَقْضِي So, تَجِبُ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ مُكَلِّفٍ, is an obligation on every Muslim mukallif. Are not obligated the non-mukallif, and the ha'il and the one in nifas during that time. Anyone else, he must pray by obligation. If he cannot pray on the time of the prayer, therefore he has to make up the prayer. That's what we want to study, and we study part of it. قَالَ وَيَقْضِي, so the one who didn't pray on the time of the prayer, he has to make up the prayer. Who? This is al-qadha'u bi'udhr. This permission is being given to those who have excuses, who have condition, who have reason why they didn't pray on the time. Why they pray, didn't pray on time. So it will be given to him the permission to make qada, to make qada. Who are these people? Who are the category of these people? Qala or mukallafin, qala man zala aqluhu binawmin. The one who on the time of the prayer, he was mentally non-present, like being asleep. So he cannot be addressed to be talked to or be ordered, ordained to do the action as long as he sleeps. And we mentioned that as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, قَالَ مَنْ نَامَ عَنْ صَلَاةٍ أَوْ نَسِيَهَا فَلْيُصَلِّهَا إِذَا ذَكَرَهَا لَا كَفَّارَةَ لَهُ إِلَّا ذَلِكَ. Whoever will sleep and miss a prayer, or he forget the prayer, he has to pray as soon as he remembered. And the only expiation of that, how to correct this sin or this action, not a sin, because he has a permission, he has an excuse, is to pray it as soon as he remembered. And then we mentioned how soon he can say it, do it. And we mentioned of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, when they the whole companion, they slept and the Prophet ﷺ, and the only thing that they wake them up or woke them up is the heat of the sun. And we mentioned that hadith in one of the Ghazawat, and we said like how the Prophet ﷺ command the army to move from that place, and then they moved, and after, you know, they get to a new place and they, you know, put their all their stuff and things, and then they make wudu. And the adhan and the sunnah, and after the sunnah they pray, the Prophet ﷺ led them to the prayer. So we're saying the time, it will be someone will take his time to be prepared, but not to delay it a day or two, or to delay till, you know, get to the another prayer. The delay will be conceivable in a way that someone gets ready, but not as some scholar to let it, you know, be delayed to the next prayer. قال, this is what we did last time. So this is من زال عقله بنوم. Now, أو بإغماء, أو إغماء. إغماء, someone, he faint, he lose consciousness. And the unconsciousness can come either with someone's choice or without choice. With the choice, for example, someone would take something that caused him to fall unconscious, like a sedative or something, you know, that he needs to take. بغير اختياره, like someone has condition like epilepsy or something, subhanAllah, faint without even, or extreme, you know, tiredness and or sickness. This is أحوال المغمى عليه, someone, he will lose consciousness. فالمصنف, the author here, قال وإغماء. إغماء, and consciousness include all the types that with his choice or without his choice. The scholar, they have two sayings concerning this case. The saying, once someone in a state is unconsciousness, is he mukallaf or non-mukallaf? Is he mukallaf or non-mukallaf? What it means, mukallaf, is he in a state to be addressed to the order, or at that time of his unconsciousness, he is not, you know, in the field or candidate to apply to him the order. Like the one who more mukallaf, the one who he doesn't have the age, reach the age of puberty. For example, someone who doesn't have the age of puberty cannot tell him to pray by obligation. It's not an obligation on him. So when we say mukallaf in time of unconsciousness, the one who is in that time, is he mukallaf or not mukallaf? Is he obligated with the khitab of sharia, with the speech, with the order of the sharia or not? And this is the two saying of the scholars. Now, when we study this, every saying has its consequences. If we say mukallaf, therefore he has to make up the prayer that he missed during the unconsciousness. If we say he's not mukallaf, then he doesn't have to make up the prayer. قال كل من أغمي عليه فهو مكلف ويبقى إلى أن يفيق فيطالب بقضاء الصلوات وقضاء الأيام التي فرض الله عليها فيها الصيام. So in that time of unconsciousness, all the prayer, all the fast that he missed, when he wakes up again, when he comes back to his conscience, he has to make them up. There's a narration narrated on, you know, on behalf of Imam Ahmed, one narration which is not the main madhab. And some of the Salaf, rahimahumullah, قال أن المغمى عليه ليس بمكلف. The one who is unconscious is not mukallaf. And then when he comes back to his consciousness, he is not asked to make up what he missed during the unconsciousness. And the benefit of the difference of opinion, as we mentioned. So one opinion said that he has, based on his takrif or not, he has to make it up. And others, they say he doesn't have, because in the time of unconsciousness, he was out of taklif. Now, the unconsciousness, it has, you know, a case between two known cases. The first known case is the one who's sleeping. The second known case is the one who's mentally disabled, the insane, majnun. The mentally disabled, if he wakes up from his, you know, of his insanity, of his mental problem, he doesn't have to do anything because he's like born again. But for the one who sleeps, he has to make up his prayer. And the one who's unconscious, the scholar, they come between these two. Is he closer to the mental disabled, or is he closer to a man? But in reality, he's closer to a man, to the one who's sleeping. So he has to make up. Because the disabled, mentally disabled, there is no, I mean, in his condition, there is no evident cure. So we know that he's insane, he's not going to pray, he's not mukallaf at all. So in the beginning, the mental, he doesn't have the mental capacity to do it. But the one unconscious, he had the mental capacity. It was gone because of his time of unconsciousness, and when he woke up, so he's closer to the one asleep than to the one who's mentally disabled. Therefore, he has to make up everything he missed during his unconsciousness. Now, you will understand more this issue, I will not mean understand the importance of this issue, when we talk about what we call al-maut as-sarir, people like, you know, the people like what they call the vegetables, they are like for maybe months under the, you know, on their bed, they don't move, they don't, they cannot hear. So it's like, you know, what they call it, in a way, like, just with the alert, with the, that's what they call it?
Life support.
So, you know, subhanAllah, they call it like, you know, someone, they have the term also, vegetable, that's what they call it?
Vegetarian state.
So, what is the hukum of this people? Because it might go to years. If we consider them like the disabled, mentally disabled, so if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them the opportunity to come back to their normal life, to their consciousness, would they have to redo all of what they missed or not? Studying the case, as in the beginning they have full capacity of their mental capacity, if they come back from this state, they have to redo everything they know. Because they were obligated in that time. And this is one of the saying of the scholar, because he's saying he wasn't, when he went to this state, he wasn't mentally disabled. But he went for the state for Allahu A'lam, what situation he has, a stroke or things that make him to be in this situation. So when he comes back, and Allah granted that after a few months, after years, he has to make them up. Now, the question how he can make them up. So the scholars, they say, if he was absent for a few days, then he has to make up those few days right then. I mean, with his own convenience, but right then. But if it's long, then he has to put them in order with every salat. And he starts with the one he missed, and then he prayed the present salat. For the years he was absent, 2 years, 3 years. 3 years, every prayer, he prayed, for example, the Dhuhr, missed one, and then the Dhuhr of that day, for the time that he was unconscious. And this is the Aqrab, the closest to the Usul, and the closest for the Ahwat, for someone to have fulfilled what he missed during the time of inconsistency. And that's why he يقول قال ويقضي من زال عقله بنوم أو إغماء. So he has to make up whoever who mentally wasn't capable to understand, to fulfill the obligation by sleep or inconsistency. So inconsistency entered in it, or the all the types that we mentioned. And of course, he said there's a difference of opinion for those scholars who assimilate the case of the unconsciousness to the mental disease, the al-majnun. قال هي one of the شراح saying قال فانظر رحمك الله أيهما أقرب إلى الأصل. Look which one, which is the closest to the origin, to the أصل. I mean, should someone will put close to the one sleeping or the one who's mentally disabled. قال فإذا نظرت إلى أن الأصل وجوب الصلاة عليه وتكليفه احتطت للشارع. If you see like the obligation of this person before he fall unconscious, it was obligatory on him to pray. So he keep the safe side when he comes back, say, pray what you have missed. The disabled, he was not even, you know, addressed by the Sharia to pray from the beginning. But this one who fell unconscious, he was. And it's not a mental disability that he has, it's a condition that no one knows he might come back or not. فَيُطَالَبُ بِالْقَضَى يُطَالَبُ بِالْقَضَى. Of course, some scholars, they say, in the time of unconsciousness, everything has been dropped, and he should, I mean, and he's not obligated to redo them. The next one is مَنْ ذَالَ عَقْلُهُ بِسُكْرٍ. Someone is in a state of drunkenness, intoxicated. Now, the state of drunkenness that someone will lose his, you know, mental capacity in this situation. When we say mental capacity, that he is not be able to understand what he's saying. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited for as-sakran, the one in this state, to come close to the prayer. قَالَ حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُلُونَ Then الْعِلَّةِ قَالَ وَلَا تَقَرَوُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى. Which is being abrogated because the alcohol intoxicant is haram. But the إِلَّة, the reason to understand, that is forbidden to come to the prayer in a state when someone doesn't know what he said. That's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited the prayer when someone is dozing. When someone is very sleepy, he should not pray. In the hadith of the Sahih, because the Prophet ﷺ said, you don't know, you think in making dua for yourself, you are making dua against yourself. So when someone is in that state, he will go sleep. And the Prophet ﷺ said, when you wake up, you pray. So sometimes people, they stay late, and at late, he wants to pray Isha. He cannot even stand. And when he say Allahu Akbar, mix of dreams and things, that he say, he doesn't know if saying the Fatiha right or not. He's forbidden to pray at that time, go sleep. That's what the Prophet ﷺ told me. Therefore, anyone who is in a state of drunkenness, of, you know, foggy mind, because of an intoxicant or something else, he should not pray. So, قال, السكر قد يكون بسبب مباح أو بسبب غير مباح. This state of drunkenness, of this temporary mental situation, it might be something because of something that is permissible or something that is haram. Permissible, like, you know, subhanAllah, someone that gives him drug or sedative when he's going to into surgery or things like that. Or someone drank something that they put for him things that is subhanAllah intoxicant without his knowledge. So the state that he get in into it, it wasn't haram. He's not sinful for it because he didn't know what they gave him. Or he didn't know what he was drinking. So this is ma'dur. These people are forgiven to be in this state. Or someone who is forced to drink intoxicant, to be given drugs. He was forced. So this one is forgiven. This one is forgiven. But there's other, they use intoxicant. It's either liquid or the substance of whatever type of drugs that people they take. For both of them, they should not pray in that state, because they don't know what to say, but it's an obligation for them to make the prayer. At that time, إِنَّهُ غَيْرُ مُكَلَّفٌ بِالصَّلَاةِ. He's not supposed to pray in that situation. وَيُطَالَبُ بِقَضَائِهَا بَعْدَ الْإِفَاقَةِ. And then when he's awake back sober, he has to pray and to make up his prayer. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nisa, ayah 43, that I mentioned, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقَرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُ. Don't come close to the prayer and you are in state of being drunk or in this type of state to know what you say. I mean, the salah is a communication, is a connection with Allah. How can you stand in that situation and you don't know what you say? قال هنا الشارح فدل على أنه أثناء السكر لا يطالب بالصلاة. So during this period of drunkenness, someone is not required, is not asked to pray. But when he comes back to his full capacity, then is an obligation for him to pray. Now, if he did it in a haram way, he's been committing a major sin. But this major sin would be related to the action of him taking intoxicant. The hukum of salah is something else. So someone cannot say, drinking is haram for you to pray. That's wrong. You're drinking, you're making a major sin. Better for you to repent. But now you should not pray. When you go back and be sober, you have to finish to make up your prayer. That's how the hukum to say it. Because some people, they think when someone, for example, is committing such a major sin, he also should not pray. He will say, why are you praying? You've been doing drinking. It's haram for you to pray. So it's haram to say that. What is going to happen to repent if you tell him haram to pray? Well, the salat is going to bring him back. Then قال وسكر ونحو ولا تصح من مجنون ولا كافر. The salat, even if performed by some type of people, the salat is not accepted. The first one is al-majnoon. The mentally disabled, his salat is not accepted because he's not mukallaf. He's not mukallaf. Rufi'a anhu al-qalam. The qalam is marfu. No recording, no registration of anything he does is being registered on him. وَالصَّحَّةُ تَسْتَلْزِمُ وُجُودَ الثَّوَابِ. And the fulfilling the condition and making the action of worship the way being described in the Sharia, which is mean to fulfill this condition and obligation, that when the thawab, that when the reward will be given. So there is no reward of the action if the condition and the obligation of the action of worship is being done. So if the majnoon will pray, in the beginning he's not mukallaf, so he will not have any reward because there is no condition fulfilled. Therefore his salat is not accepted because he's not able to fulfill the condition of salat. That's why he's not mukallaf. You say, you don't pray. Subhanallah, the word of these people, the Prophet called the mubtala. He's in a test, he's a trial, subhanallah. غير مكلف غير مكلف لا تصح الصلاة. His salat is not accepted. Now when we say his salat is not accepted, don't think about that if we pray he should be rewarded. Don't think like there's a lack of mercy here. Be careful. We're talking about the structure of the salat based on a condition in the jurisprudence point of view. Because he's not mukallaf, and mukallaf, he will not gonna be accountable for what he's doing. Accountable for the mukallaf, the non-mukallaf is not accountable. concerning the asabi, we mentioned, the child, we mentioned that he will be rewarded, but not, you know, blame or punish if he will not do it, the prayer before the puberty. But he will be rewarded. But not the case of the Majnun. The case of Majnun, his salat is not accepted. Actually, they do not pray. And if they pray, they follow. There is no help. They don't have any connection. SubhanAllah, in the state. Then, qala wala kafir. And a disbeliever, his salat is not accepted. Why? The disbeliever, his salat is not accepted. لِأَنَّهُ مُخَاطَبْ بِالْأَصْلِ. First, he's been ordered with the foundation that comes, precede the salat, which is the testimony of faith. If he doesn't have testimony of faith, which is the condition of the action of worship in Islam, therefore he's not accepted. The Prophet ﷺ, as in the hadith of Mu'adh, he taught us that the salah is an order to be fulfilled after the shahadatayn. If there is no shahadatayn, there is no even takbir of salah. The hadith that you mentioned of du'a, dalla ala an tawajjuh الخطاب عليهم يتوجه الخطاب عليهم بالصلاة وصحتها منهم بعد تحصيل الشهادتين. After he fulfilled the شهادتين, then they will be ordered by the salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in those who not believe in the way of Allah, قَالَ وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and we came to all the deeds that they did. Deeds who presumed to be good deeds. Allah made them to be like the dust in the wind. You see, when there's small particle of dust in a strong wind, subhanAllah, there will be flying away, you don't see anything. So if you see like a mountain of dust with a strong wind, subhanAllah, take it away. That's how will be the deeds of the non-believer. Because those good deeds are image, with not doesn't have any foundation, which is the belief in Allah. Therefore, the king of the day of judgment is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, you bring good deeds, which is not founded with the king, how you want it to be accepted? It's a very simple example. You are in a place where they only accept one currency. And you want to buy something, you want to reward yourself with something you want. You get to the store, you get them the currency of another country, you say, we don't accept this. But this is true, look. He said, yes, it's true over there, not here. Go convert it. Okay? Same thing, you bring something authentic, good deeds, someone build the hospital, then you bring coming to the agenda you want to be rewarded for. He said, you didn't do it for the king of this day. If there's another day, another king, another creator, that you did it for him, he might give you, but not here. It's very simple. It's very simple. فَدَلَّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْكَافِرَ لَا تَصُحُّ مِنْهُ قُرْبًا وَلَا طَعَةً. Whatever they do from قُرْبًا or action of worship, it will not be accepted. As in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُعَجِّلُ لِلْكَافِرِ دُنْيَاهِ بِحَسَنَاتِهِ. Allah will ask him for the disbeliever his dunya, he give him a lot in his dunya because of the good deeds he did. So he will be rewarded in the dunya. But cannot be rewarded in the akhirah because the reward of the akhirah based on the faith, on the iman. حَتَّى إِذَا وَافَ اللَّهَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَافَاهُ وَلَيْسَتْ لَهُ حَسَنَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. When he comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he doesn't have any good deed that he can claim. فلذلك لا تصح منه صلاته أو لا تصح منه صلاته ولا تقبل منه عبادته. It will not be accepted from him his worship. Now, ولا تصح من مجنون ولا كافر فإن صلى فمسلم حكما. What do you mean فإن صلى؟ So it will not accept it from an insane, mentally disabled, or from a kafir, a non-believer in the faith of Islam, because this reward based on the belief in faith in Allah's will. فإن صلى, if someone will pray, فَمُسْلِمٌ حُكْمًا, he's a Muslim. In the law of Islam, he's Muslim. Someone come to the masjid, stand, you know, in the row, say Allahu Akbar, pray the full prayer, he's a Muslim. He's a Muslim. حُكْمًا, we don't know what is in his heart. قال, and this is an important point, because عند العلماء there's what we they call القضاء والديانة. القضاء والديانة. القضاء are the matters related to the jurisdictional system, to the law of the jurisprudence, related to the system of the court and related to the judge who will, you know, give the verdict or give the sentence. This is a qadha. Ad-diyanatu is in the system of the faith. Two different aspects, two different real. And Islam, subhanAllah, they take it in consideration in a very fair and just way. Now, look, based on the qadha, and in the ahkam are implemented based on al-dhahir. The ahkam are implemented because there's, when we say, for example, what is the hukum of the money in the hand of a believer? Zakat. The hukum of the money in the hand of the non-believer. Depends where he resides, if he's in the state of Islam and everything, he has to pay the tax that we call jizya, etc., etc. The hukum of marriage for a believer. The hukum of marriage for a non-believer. So this is our ahkam concerning everyone in the Islamic, you know, society based on his faith. Right? So the hukum here is implemented, the law is implemented based on the person, how he identifies himself. Come to a person, who are you, this is said, say, I am a Muslim. So the ahkam of Islam will be implemented on him, applied for him. Do the hakim or the one who asks him have the right to check and investigate is a Muslim or not? No. If he said, I am a Muslim, he's a Muslim. So the حكم على الضال على الباطن نوكل الباطن بالله سبحانه وتعالى ونكل سريرته إلى الله. We entrust his hidden, what he has inside, to Allah. But when you come to the قضاء, if you say I'm Muslim, so you implement and you apply with him the law of Islam. And he has the right of a Muslim in the society because he is Muslim. And the very obvious example is the presence of the hypocrite in the temple of the Prophet. They protect, they live in full safety, they have all the right of Muslims, they pray with the Prophet, everything. So this is what we call al-qadha. Al-qadha is related to the jurisdictional system. أن حديث الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إنما أمرت أن أخذ بظواهر الناس. I've been ordered to deal with people what they you know they deal with us, the way they whatever they make it appear to us and the way they behave, That's what how we deal with them. وَأَنْ أَكِلْ سَرَائِرَهُمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ. But I entrust their secret to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanAllah, no one had the means to dig in the heart of the people. If you said you're Muslim, you have by obligation to deal with them as a Muslim. Unless there is proof that he's not. I mean, proof with hujjah, not with presumption. I don't think, I mean, the way he's standing, I don't think he's a Muslim. You don't have the right to say because there's no way for anyone to know his intention and his, whatever his qasd. And that's why we need ask it and order when we want to compliment someone. We say, لَا نُزَكِّي عَلَى اللَّهِ أَحَدًا قُلْ نَحْسَبُهُ كَذَلِكَ. We think, we presume that he's a good person because the inside only Allah knows. قَالْ أَحْسِبُهُ وَاللَّهُ حَسْبُهُ. Allah knows. But أَحْسِبُهُ, I presume that he's a good person. MashaAllah, I see him in the masjid and everything, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the same. And this sarira will be only, no one wants someone getting the grave. فَإِذَا بُعْثِرَ مَا فِي الْقُبُورِ وَحُصِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. So if only حُصِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ, the only knows, the all-knowing, al-alim al-khabir, therefore when it comes to the Ahkam of Islam, we have to restrict, the qualification or the way of how to apply al-ahkam, al-asma' wal-ahkam in the aqidah and the sharia, based on what someone he presents himself. The way he presents himself, you need to deal with him that way. He said, I'm a Muslim, you consider as a Muslim and you apply on him the ahkam of Islam. As we mentioned the example of the munafiqeen in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Quran saying that the hypocrites are in the lowest level of hellfire. Why are they praying with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The only one who knew who are the munafiqeen is Hudhayfah, only one sahaba. حتى أتاه عمر, عمر came to the حذيفة, قال in the hadith, أناشدك الله أكنت في من سمى لك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He came begging حذيفة, he said, am I in the list that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave you? حذيفة got mad, he said, look, I only gonna tell you, لا أزكي إلا غير, لا أزكي أحدا بعد. And he said, أزكي, أزكي is like I'm saying something good about you. She's talking Umar, I mean, Farouk. I say, I will not say to anybody else except you, after you. Don't ask me. So Umar, he was so happy. But later on, the companion after the Prophet, the death of the Prophet, everyone, they see Hudhayfa not praying on his janazah, they know he's a munafiq. Among them, Umar, he will be always following Hudhayfa. When people, they were carrying a janazah, they see Hudhayfa in the back. If Hudhayfa, one of the street, you turn, Umar, he knows him, he'll leave. That's how the company, how to use, after the person died, their sign is Hudhayfah, is praying on him or not. And they've been living among the Muslims, and they've been given the rights of Islam, and everything. I mean, from the inheritance, and the munakaha, and the mu'amalat, everything. And this is what we call al-qadha. الديانة الله سبحانه وتعالى will deal with you with what you have in your heart. I mean, you being Muslim among the society, being given, but inside someone is disbeliever, Allah will call him accountable not on his action in front of the people, of the what he has as intention. Example, that we can give an example this way. For example, someone, The word of talaq is from al-ahkam al-wada'iyya, which means there's ahkam ريليتد تو ذا مكلف تكليفيه. الاحكام وضعيه. الاحكام التكليفيه بسبب ان شاء الله يسوع فقط اذا احكام ريليتد تو ذا اكشن اوف ذا بليفر يوسف لايك صلاه. You have to do the salat. No one else will do the salat for you. أحكام الوضعية is a حكم that is not related to the mukallaf but obligates you to respect it or obligates you to consider it in the حكم that you do. For example, I want to pray Dhuhr. So you cannot pray till the time of Dhuhr. The time of Dhuhr is حكم وضعي. It's not related to the mukallaf. That's something that I need to consider in fulfilling the ahkam. Some of the scholars they say the word of talaq is hukm wada, not related to the mukallaf, which is mean doesn't is not even connected to your intention. The separation happened by saying the word. That's it. You say someone I didn't intend it. They said qada'an. There's separation. Diyanatan, you're not divorced. This is the difference. Because the word caused the separation in the jurisdictional system. But your intention, you didn't intend it. For Allah, you're not separated. But you have to implement the laws of separation. Why? Because according to the qada, you've been separated. In front of the judge, you said, Judge, I cannot get into your heart. You said talaq? He said yes, that's it, separated. But diyanatan he's not. From the point of view of faith, he's not. But from the point of view of the hukum, ahkam, the law, he is. That's why when someone says a word, that it might have both meaning. Not the word talaq, because talaq is known. But he said, for example, say, you are free. So the woman said, I'm free, sorry, this is a divorce. She go to the hakim, she said, no, this is separation. We have to implement the law of separation. But he can say, no, I didn't mean with it what she thought. So as the word has ihtimam, it has doubt. So here the qadi will make him to swear by Allah that he didn't mean it. That they go back to his diyana. And this diyana will apply only the qadha, the hukum. And this is the difference, very important for a student of knowledge to make this separation. Because there's also the difference between fatwa and qada. And may someone give you fatwa, but the same person who's going to be the judge, he can do the different thing. So the fatwa is a solution. The qada is a verdict, it's a sentence, different. The same thing, qada is a verdict. It needs to go with something that are standard, no one. Things mabuta. I mean mabuta like فيها ضوابط واضحة. That's a very correct and known norms and measure. We cannot make the hukum based on intention. I mean someone, what was your intention? And someone that cannot have a system of law based on such a thing. That's why the qada, the word talaq, it means talaq. You didn't mean it, that's something else. That's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in the judicial system, this is the benefit of knowing the qada and al-diyan, al qada wa al-diyan. Therefore, qada for someone who say I'm Muslim, by the obligation you have to deal with him with that and fulfill for him all the rights of Islam. If he wants to marry a Muslim, he has the right, the full right. You cannot say, I'm doubting that you are not Muslim. You cannot say that. But diyanatan, if he's not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, here we call Musanna fa'in salla. So, if the kafir will pray, he is Muslim hukman, not diyanatan, hukman. By the law of Islam, by the law of the jurisprudence of Islam, he is a Muslim. Therefore, you have to deal with him and have a relationship with him in mu'amalat with the law of Islam. Not the law of Islam always implemented, but to have by obligation to observe the right of Muslim toward them. Like the inheritance and the marriage, etc. The next is you call ويؤمر بها صغير لسبع ويضرب عليها بعشر ويضرب ويؤمر. So here comes to when the prayer starts. متى يؤمر الصبي بالصلاة ويضرب عليها. When the child is being ordered to pray and when he need to be followed up with him with correction and being like someone he is like firm with him. You say ضرب is more in the society of Islam than correcting. And of course, ضرب, one of the way of correcting is to beat. And the beating here always don't put it in the connotation what the people in some society they want to associate it with, which is to be like, you know, someone with no heart and someone like rude and harsh and, you know, fall into harassment and fairness of us. No such a thing, you know, to be associated with this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ or into the fiqh of Islam. Because the most caring parents, you know, especially Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, are the parents in one of the obligation, not obligation, I mean, one of the principle of the Holy Spirit of the Sharia is this kindness and the love that exists in the household. Therefore, this is the correction comes from the nature of the human being, because in this age, if you say to a child stop, he will not stop. And there's way how to communicate to get him the connection. If you say to the child, do not touch the fire, he will not understand. He will be always playing around the fire. He only stops when he touches the fire. Why? Because he wants to feel the hurt of touching the fire. So he doesn't have the capacity to understand. So the beating in its way of correction, not like in extreme, because the beating is like something to correct. It's like something coming from those who love them the most in the world, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is his own parents. I mean, the government cannot love the child more than parents. We're talking about parents that we know. Not talking about abusive parents, intoxicated, drug parents, they don't know even if they have a child or not. You know, they say, who is this? They say, he's your child. And they didn't know I had a child. Why? Because these people, they don't know even what they got the child. We're talking about Muslim families, Muslim society, following the footsteps of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they are the most who love their own children. And they care about their children. Because the objective of every parent to have their children with them in paradise. So if they correct them for that great purpose, and the love that they have is something, is not murakkab, is not something they build or they try to produce. It's natural because it is in the way we pray, it is in the way we believe, it is in the way we behave, and it is in the way of our conduct. And that's the first, let's say, base, the first, subhanAllah, pillar of the serenity and the purity of the society started with the love that exists inside the family of Islam. If you're talking about the brotherhood, started from the love inside the family, inside the household. And this here, to understand how important is the salah in the life of a believer. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam teaching us the best way how to have a generation that they fear Allah to be the right vicegerent to really contribute in building the well-being in the whole universe when you connect them with Allah, not with the toys. And it started from 7. Because before 7, if you correct even some child, if you correct them, they will come back doing the same thing because they cannot even conceive. At 7 becomes that mumayyiz, he start to understand. He start to talk to him, he can, you know, reply. Most of the kids, some of the kids, they can have this capacity of tamiz before that. So So it's hard to practice, because in a household of Muslims, they always talk about Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the table, they say Bismillah, they say Alhamdulillah. So you cannot even, it's already the environment is there to have the child. So at 7, he started to pray and get into his training to be like, have this independence in knowing Allah. He known Allah through his parents. Now he's gonna know him and or know her, and know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his own connection. And then you try to help him or help her. When they ask about things, you can ask Allah next prayer. And then you build that connection. 18, 9 years, 10 years, the child he doesn't want, he's still like, then he need to be corrected. Now the correction at 10 years is like more follow-up, more serenity, because he's close for the qalam to be subhanAllah. So look how careful and subhanAllah concerned the parents. And more than all the parents, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of his ummah. To be concerned. At 10 you need to follow up. And the follow-up, even it comes to be severe and infer and correct. And the scholars say, not like to take a bath and you kill the kid. That's haram. Is that to be corrected? You know that you're serious. Because the children are very spoiled, they come, jump on their parents, hugging and everything. But when they see you serious, and you like even small, like you hit them, they feel like, you know, you're serious, and you're gonna be mad at them. Then that, subhanAllah, that relation, and they know who's, you know, or enveloped with the love that already rooted inside the family, that helped the child to do his prayer, to be trained, to be ready for this great mission of life. And because of its importance, and it is the backbone of the deen that is in importance for all of us, and to understand the hadith in this way. فقال ويؤمر بها صغير لسبع. Start at 7 years. ويضرب عليها لعشر. And some of our shuyukh said some comment very nice. SubhanAllah, said, who is the one who's gonna be hurt at 10? Is the child who's gonna be hurt or the parents? Try to think. The kid at 10, if you give him, you know, to a spanking and everything, you cry and then you see him running, playing. The real hurt is the parents. Because a loving parent, he doesn't want to beat a good child. So I say, this is your shortcoming. To wait out up to 10, to find yourself forced to do this follow-up because you've been heedless for 3 years. Because the parents doesn't want to beat his, I mean, talking about the parents, we know. They don't want to beat their children or to correct them, right? Because those parents who beat their children because they are mad, and the way to feel good is to do something. The first thing, they beat the children. That's very bad parenting, and that's not from Islam. People get like mad at work, from work, he comes at home, the kids are, you know, noisy, he beat them up. Why just he want to relax? That's haram, that's not the way we're talking about. So we're talking when someone comes to the situation and he hears the Prophet sallallahu say, you'll be neglecting an obligation on you, and now you've been forced to do something that you don't want to do. Why? Because of the hatred that someone had. This is in hadith, وَيُؤْمَرُ بِهَا صَغِيرٌ لِسَبْعٍ وَيُضْرَبُ عَلَيْهِ لِعَشْرٍ. And we said, the beating is correction, is to be firm, severe, and to have the child to fulfill this noble and great pillar of Islam. قال, in this hadith, we have of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said in the hadith, قال مروا أولادكم بالصلاة لسبعين وضربوهم عليها لعشرين وفرقوا بينهم في المضاجع. So in this hadith, Muru ordered your children to start the prayer at 7 and beat them or correct them at 10. وفرقوا بينهم في المضاجع. And at that age, you should separate between them in the bed. So you have like siblings. At the age of 10, they should have separate beds. Look, subhanAllah, the great quality and caring of the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فاشتمل هذا الحديث على ثلاثة أحكام. The hadith, we have three أحكام. The first is to order them to pray at 7, to correct them at 10 if they don't do it, and the third one is to تفريق بين الذكر والأنثى في المضجع, to separate between the male and female in the bed when they are on at that age. وكلام مصنف, and the author saying here, it goes exactly like the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The only difference is the scholar, they say, should they start at the beginning of the 7 or the end of the 7? And to be like being observed the correction at the beginning of the 10 or the end of the 10. Let's say beginning of the 10, he just finished the 9 and he started the 1, like 9 years and 1 day. That's the 10. Or he finished the end of 10 and he's starting 11. So this is the difference of opinion between this couple. The answer is at the end of 7 and the end of 10. Because he's not mukallaf. So if he's not mukallaf, al-aqwa, and to get to the closest to the age of takleef, so order. To go to the order age, so the end of 7 and the end of 10. Allah Ta'ala. Then, قَالَ فَإِنْ بَلْغَ فِي أَثْنَانِهَا أَوْ بَعْدَهَا فِي وَقَتِهَا أَهَا. If he reach or he get his puberty during the prayer that he was praying based on the order of practice and praying before puberty, that prayer need to be redone. Why? Because at the age of puberty he become like full mukallaf. The prayer he was doing it more for training, not under the takleef. So if he gets the age of puberty, you know, and he reaches his puberty, he has to redo the prayer. For example, if he prays God, and he wants to sleep, and when he woke up, he felt like, you know, he reaches the puberty. And before Salat al-Asr, he needs to redo the dhuhr, because now he is, you know, mukallaf. And this is applied also for Al-Ha'ar and the Mufassir. If, for example, the end of the menstruation happened in time of before Maghrib, she has to pray Dhuhr and Asr. Before Fajr, she has to pray more Badr. Because the time of Isha is still up to Fajr. And it is the time that permissible to combine between Maghrib and Isha. Therefore, they go back to Maghrib and Isha. قال مثل الحائض والنفاس فإنها لو طهرت قبل انتهاء الوقت ولو بركعة واحدة فإنها تؤمر بفعل الصلاة. So if you know someone will reach the age of puberty with the time even one rak'ah, the same for the women in state of menstruation or nifas. They have to pray. And this is based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, qala man adraka rak'atan qabla an tatlu' ash-shamsu faqad adraka al-fajr. Whoever who had the time to pray rak'ah before the sun rise, then he's qad adraka, that's the time of fajr, he still has time. So if he pray one rak'ah before the sunrise, and then the sun rises, the time of Fajr, you know, and the second rak'ah will pray it after the sun. So his Fajr is on time. His Fajr is on time. من أدرك ركعة قبل أن تطلع الشمس فقد أدرك الفجر. ومن أدرك ركعة قبل أن تغرب الشمس فقد أدرك العصر. And whoever who prayed one rak'ah before the sunset, also he prayed asr. قد أدرك العصر, so he reached asr on time. قال فدل على أن إدراك الوقت ولو بركعة واحدة يوجب الحكم والمطالبة بالفعل. So saying, based on this hadith, if someone will have still the time of one rak'ah in the time, in the remaining time of the prayer, he's obligated to offer that prayer. So someone wish liberty at the time, he has to pray. End of menstruation and things, they have to pray. And we said the combine is some of the saying of the scholar. Wow. The next issue قال فإن بلغ في أثنائها أو بعدها في وقتها this ويحرم تأخيرها عن وقتها إلا لناو الجمع ولمشتغل بشرطها الذي يحصله قريبا. And it is prohibited. It is haram to delay the prayer. Now, look, in the beginning we said, if he delayed the prayer with excuse, he has to make it up. And the excuse being inconscient, sleeping, etc. Then the prayer is not accepted from a disabled, mentally disabled, and is not accepted from the one who's in a state of kufr. Now we have another case. The case is, someone doesn't have any reason. What if he delayed the prayer? He say it is haram, is one of the big major sins. Except, and we're going to study the exception inshallah. So, delaying willingly with no reason, and what is the hukum of it, and who had the exception in this case? Any question, inshallah, before the salah?
Yeah. You talk about the munafiqun. Al-munafiqun. You know the use the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is a munafiqun in the Qumbani. And the Prophet knows. And as you know, the Quran talks about the munafiqun
The worst.
Yeah, the worst one. Yeah. But why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't? Did he tell anyone that Munafiq?
Well, the thing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's the legislator, and the legislation of the law need to be implemented after him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Only him who had the capability to know, and his source of knowledge is the revelation. Is there anyone after the Prophet ﷺ who going to receive revelation? Therefore, the teaching of the Prophet ﷺ must be a teaching that can be implemented after him. And it started with the Khulafa. So Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, it ends the time of revelation. Now we have to deal with people with the way they appear to us. He said, that Muslim, I need to deal with you as a Muslim. So the Prophet ﷺ implemented a dhahir based on the common everyone around him who do not have the way to know it by the revelation. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, he had one amin that he gave him the list. To, subhanAllah, answer the question that you have. So the Prophet knew. But the Prophet ﷺ, he will not give to anybody or to everyone. Why? Because to protect the privacy of those people, and Allah, the Prophet ﷺ addressed their, what they have in their heart to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then because of the Sharia, and this is the difference also between Al-Qadha wa Diyan. So the Prophet is teaching us how to deal with them according to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will be standard and be applicable to the end of time. And the Prophet, knowing that, he was making dua for them that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. And the head of Munafiqeen, he said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, said, if you ask forgiveness for him 70 times, Allah will not forgive him. So the Prophet said to Allah, if I know if more than 70 Allah will accept him, I will continue to make forgiveness for him. And that's the rahmah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's how we answer it, because the jurisprudence is to be applicable to the end of time. Therefore, the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam need to be based on something that can be applicable, not non-applicable, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is source of the regulation, and no one can receive the regulation after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The time of the Dhuhr, كما قالنا صلى الله عليه وسلم على عندما سئل عن أفضل الأعمال, he was asked about the best of the action. He said, قال الصلاة على وقتها, على وقتها, and another one قال في وقتها. على وقتها, the prayer on each time, and the time of the prayer, it's a window of time from the beginning to the end. So the Dhuhr, it started with the Zawar and ends before the adhan of al-Asr. That's the time of the Dhuhr. In any time you pray from in this window will be the time of the Dhuhr.
So
is
that considered on time?
Huh?
Considered on time?
On time. Ala waqtiha, it means from the beginning to the end of the time of the Dhuhr. That's the hadith, qala iman adraka raka'ata qabla shuruq al-shamsi faqad adraka al-fajr. Who even you pray one rak'ah, you are praying Dhuhr, and when you are in Sami Allahu liman hamidah, the adhan of the Asr started, you pray Dhuhr on time because you adrak taraka. And mean would mean adrak taraka. You reach a raka of one raka of Dhuhr, and the raka is being mean called adrak. You know, you have full raka when you have the tahmid, tasmi. So if you make a whole rak'ah before the adhan of the next prayer, it's going to be counted on time. And that's the limit, actually. Of course, someone would not should have it to that limit. But the time from the beginning to the end of the time, and the end of the time will be one rak'ah before the entering of the time of the next prayer.
So those who delay the prayer, basically saying it's from...
After the adhan of Asr. Yes.
That's the delay.
That's the delay.
A lot of people
just confuse
and say delay. They call
us,
I should be.
No. I mean, when someone is like, he hear the adhan, I said, I have to pray it now. If not, I will be ended in the wa'id and threat of the hadith now. No, that's not. Yes.
But for Maghrib, is there a different case? For Maghrib when the sun sets?
No, it's not. But the Maghrib, the time of Maghrib is dayyaq. It's no one is very restricted time. But it's not, because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is general hadith. And it goes up to the before the disappearance of the redness in the horizon. And inshallah we're gonna study that in Bab Mawaqit al-Salah. We study that in Bab Mawaqit al-Salah.
When should we come back?
When should we come back?